and gentlemen, welcome to episode 7 of Power Up, your favorite superhero podcast. My name is D. Marchese, otherwise known as the Beast NJ, and joining me as always is my faithful co-host and sidekick, Gregory Virga. Ooh-hoo! I'm sorry for your eardrums, everybody.
Hi, ladies and gentlemen. How are you doing today? I'm doing great. Thanks for asking. Great.
Everyone's so glad. We're all so glad to hear it. This is Power Up, your first stop for all things superheroes, and it's live on Patreon on Tuesdays at patreon.com/levelupnetwork. All you have to do is donate $1 a month to get the exclusive timed access there. Otherwise, for everyone else, you can catch this on Saturdays at 10 a.m. audio and video version at youtube.com/thelevelupshow. Level spelled L-V-L.
That's crazy that all they have to do is just do $1 and then they get our whole amazing best show.
Yeah, and soon have an exclusive episode.
That's going to be the exclusive episodes are going to be cray cray.
Yeah, we haven't really talked about that still, but we're there's a lot going on right now. We're getting there.
We have the oil in the cogs.
In the cogs. Yeah.
Yes. Is that a thing that people do?
You should oil cogs if you want your clock to work correctly. I would assume you would oil your cogs. Yeah.
Wait. Side note. As you know, there's always side notes with Gregory. What is the name of the clock from Beauty and the Cogsworth?
Cogsworth, yeah.
Yeah. I can die happy now, ladies and gentlemen. You're welcome.
So
and
what's
go
going on with you, man? Anything new?
Okay. This is what I have to say.
Oh,
all right.
Shit.
So I know we talk about superheroes and stuff, but I haven't done anything with my life except work for 82 hours this past week.
That's brutal.
Make my money and play this game on mobile phones. It's by the developer Scopefly, and they're working with Skybound Entertainment, which is over at the Walking Dead studios.
Okay.
And it's a Walking Dead mobile game.
Oh, nice. Is
Go
it good?
Buy it's it. It's free. You don't even have to buy it. Go download it. It's the most beautiful thing I've ever done in my life, and it's got me through this week.
Is it Walking Dead in like the same vein as Telltale stuff?
No, what it is it's like turn-based combat, so like Final Fantasy, but with Walking Dead characters that you can upgrade over time, and then they also give you like a Farmville like farm plot that you can like grow supplies and build materials and craft things, and it's fucking awesome.
That sounds really cool.
And I love The Walking Dead, as we all know. I'm like,
yes, you do. Love yourself some Walking Dead.
Some Walking Dead. But what's new with you? Did you find any cool games?
Not much, man. I had a long week and a rough week, and I'm not going to get into all that, but just had some family stuff happening this week. It was just a real long one. Worked a lot. Real tired from all that. And I've been playing some more Disney Infinity. It's really, really good. I just got into the toy box mode where you can like create just create whatever you want pretty much. And that's really awesome. And then I started playing, I'm cleaning up my backlog, which if you're just here for the superhero stuff and you're not really into video games, the backlog is, just all the games that you've missed that you have and you haven't gotten a chance to play them or beat them yet, that then they pile up into a list.
Retweet.
So yeah, I'm making some good progress. I only have four games left on it. And, yeah, I murdered, dude. I went real hard at it. But the one I'm doing right now is Castlevania Lords of Shadow 2.
Oh.
It is not very good.
Yeah, I heard that.
Lords of Shadow 1 was really good. I loved it. This one jumps from, like, old, like, Victorian, like, Castle Dracula stuff to, like, modern day and, like, New York City. It's bad.
What?
It's not good. But the stuff that does take place, like, back in the day is cool. It's fun. It's all gothic and stuff, and I like that, but... Yeah, it's not
so good. What I heard is that Dracula's coming to New York City.
Yeah, you nailed it.
I live there.
I'm excited. I'm just going to blow through it, honestly. I'm just ready to get through it so I can move on. But that's about it for me this week, man. Anything else you want to add before we get started here?
In superhero news.
Yeah.
Our shows are coming up very soon.
Yes, they are. And I'm excited about that.
Flash and Arrow. And I'm going to poop when that happens.
Yeah, I think everyone's going to poop everywhere.
I hope so. Wait, yeah. That's like my dream, I feel like. I feel like that's like my dream for life is just everyone to poop and be happy about it. Like, don't talk about poop like it's a disgusting thing, people. Like, we all do it. Like, fart if you want to fart. Poop if you want to poop. Greg for president 2020.
Let's get into some news here, Greg. Number one, speaking of our shows... Are you ready for this, Greg?
Segue,
oh, thank you so much.
That's the
new Arrow season 4 poster has been revealed with the tagline "Aim higher."
Oh, aim period higher period.
Well, you don't read periods. But no, here's a look at the poster.
Oh, God.
A new look at the Arrow uniform. He looks great, dude.
I feel like this is what we've been waiting for all of our lives.
Yeah, he looks on point. Love
Question
it.
Question to you.
What do you got?
Do you think that his like arm hook thing, yeah, like do you think that's attached to his sleeve armor, or do you think that's just like the extension of the bow from his back?
That's the other end of the bow.
Oh, I wanted it to be like a crossbow on his arm, like Assassin's Creed.
Oh, that would be fucking awesome.
I feel like they should do that.
It's if you look at the front of the bow, you can see it's curved out like that. I think it's just the other end.
Damn, I got so excited.
But he looks awesome, man, and he's looking pretty jacked right now too, I gotta say.
You could see his veins on his arms.
Yeah, I love it. How do you feel about the costume though?
I like it a lot. I think it's more practical for his uses. I feel like it shields the part that needs to be shielded, but I think it's also aerodynamic enough that when he's shooting arrows, it makes sense that he's not in a green tunic.
I like it much better than the second iteration. I actually liked the first iteration where he just kind of wore tattered rags and smeared like grease paint.
Yeah,
kind
of like it reminded me of like Daredevil's like just black.
Yeah, I like
the beginning. Yeah,
that was really cool. But this seems like a really great evolution. I'm a big fan. And then the tagline here, which I feel like we should discuss, aim higher. That's got to be a nod to season 3, right? Like they had to. Easily. I feel like they're intentionally being like, we know it wasn't great, and this is going to be better.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's there's very self-aware. That's why we love the show so much, is like into pop culture references that they do, especially with the Flash as well, like coming on board last season with season 1. They did awesome in revealing just how much they're self-conscious and self-aware. So I think that's a tagline more so for themselves, like, guys, we know we fucked up last season. Yeah. So we're going to come back and we're going to make it perfect for you. Like,
it's cool though that they're willing to admit their flaws and they're even making light of it, and they're promising that they're going to do better. So I'm all about this poster.
I'm all about this base, no trouble. I don't know why I turned Jamaican, but that happened.
Don't we all turn Jamaican when we talk about the Arrow?
Retweet.
In other Arrow news, the season 4 trailer has debuted at Dragon Con.
That's a thing.
It was great. We both really enjoyed it, right? But I think we would agree
was it good?
We would agree probably. Well, I will see if you agree, but I don't think it broke the internet, as the executive producer said a couple weeks back. I was expecting, I was expecting Batman to drop in like air. Like, I was like, this didn't break the internet. It was good. It was very, very good.
I literally thought the same thing. Like, I thought they were going to show like Stephen Amell like go into Batman vs Superman or something crazy. I'm like, that's not breaking the internet. I'm like, you're on the CW. Like, let's back up and slow our roll a bit.
I mean, there's things they could have done with the like elements that they have to work with within that show that could have, you know, come close to making a bigger dent. But like, it was a great trailer. It did not break the internet at all.
No. It's not Kim Kardashian's butt.
No, it's not Kim Kardashian's, but we could definitely agree on that.
That was the last thing I knew to break the internet.
But it was good. It showed Felicity and Arrow.
Yes!
It showed them in where they wound up landing at the end of season 3. Spoilers. Spoiler alert for season 3. If you haven't watched it, I'll give you 2 seconds. There you go.
So my favorite part is...
What do you got?
When she's sitting on the counter and he comes back from like his morning jog and she's just cooking eggs, like reading like a science fiction magazine. And then he's like, hey, babe. And then I kiss. And I'm like, this is what I want Arrow to be kind of. Like, this is what I wish it could be, like a soap opera. And like Thea comes in and they're like, Speedy.
That sounds like my worst nightmare. But all right, whatever you like, what you like, I guess. But at the end of season 3, he gives up being the Arrow. He drives off. Do they think Arrow died? Is that right or no?
Yeah, he faked his death. Yeah,
right. The people of the city.
Everyone of Starling City thinks that he's dead now.
Right.
Or so, Stephen Amell's Arrow, excuse me.
Right.
So Oliver Queen is dead.
Right. Which that version of the Arrow works, because then when he eventually does come back as the Green Arrow, everyone's like, oh, this is someone else pretending to be the Arrow because Oliver Queen is dead. So I guess that's the way they're gonna. It doesn't really work for me that well, but I'll look over it just because we do want to see more of the show. We see them in their vacation house. We see a lot of stuff. We see them coming back. We get looks at the new suit. We get a look at Thea as Arsenal. So she's actively a part of the team now. We see some weird stuff with her and the pit. Like, it looks like she doesn't quite have her rage under control from coming out of the pit.
Wait, so my favorite two parts, actually I have three favorite parts of the trailer. Can I nail them for you?
Yeah, hit me.
My first one is when Laurel Black Canary comes up to Thea Queen and she's like, listen, Bobo, we have to be here now as the protectors of the city. And Thea's like, okay. And they show a scene of her dressed up as Arsenal in the pickup truck, the back of a pickup truck, and she's just beating the shit out of people. Like, yeah. She looks beautiful.
Some of it looks really good.
My second favorite part is we see a flicker of Constantine lighting his cigarette.
Yeah, that was cool.
And we see Sarah Lance come out of the pit. Because yep. Sarah Lance is going to be revived, guys. Yes, I love her. She's so much better.
Yeah, but this is all going to lead into what I chose for our topic of the week this week. So I'm not going to bring it up now, but put a pin in that point you just mentioned because I want to get back to that later on.
And then the last part, which we have written down here, no McDonoghue is here as Damian Dark. He's finally appeared. Thank God we didn't get another fake out.
He looks good. He looks really good as Damian Dark. I'm glad we finally get to see Damian Dark. Neil McDonoghue, if you don't know, he's been in a lot of other stuff, but probably more recently to our general audience, you might have noticed him from Captain America, the First Avenger. He played Dum Dum Dugan in that.
Dum Dum Dugan.
Which was a good buy, but... It seems like now he's going the villain route, which I think he'll play a little bit better, honestly.
Do you feel like Dum Dum Dugan should be like a candy bar?
I think it is a candy bar. No, it's
not. No! Can we make it?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Okay, and then my favorite part of the whole trailer is at the end where there's this like random black guy that comes to help out Felicity, like, because now she owns Queen Industries, lest we forget. She's the CEO. Mm-hmm. So this guy like comes on to kind of be like her assistant, which is good. Finally, she's not someone's bitch. Like, she has a bitch to have like ordered around. And he goes in the elevator after the shootout happens. And she like punches this guy in the face before he can get into the elevator. And the guy goes, since when were you such a badass? And she goes,
oh, yeah.
He goes, since always. I'm like, yeah, this is perfect. I'm like, I love it.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff in the trailer. Some things that weren't in the trailer that Stephen Amell discussed in an interview with IGN at Dragon Con. Is confirming that the flashbacks that we talked about will be back. Now, there's some good and there's some bad to this, Greg. I know you don't want the flashbacks. We're over the flashbacks.
I hate the flashbacks.
Here's what he said. There's going to be some magic and mysticism. I don't know if that's a word, but that's what he said.
Yeah, I like that word.
That takes place in season 4. So we're going to start seeing some magical elements, which makes sense because Constantine's going to be in there and, you know, all this kind of stuff. But, the flashbacks will show when Oliver was originally introduced to magical elements being a real thing. So when he sees them come to fruition within season 4 in current day,
he won't be like Ash.
It's not going to be this whole like, what? Like, he's going to be the only one who's like, I had a feeling this was coming and now we're in trouble. Which I actually really like that use of flashbacks.
And they keep saying that the whole reason in the trailer why Oliver is coming back and has to put on the arrow suit again is this guy named Ghost.
Right.
Who we know nothing about.
Yeah.
And he's coming, and Laurel as Black Canary can't, her scream, her, what is that? Her constipated scream, we'll call it.
Yeah.
Is Canary not going to be able to, we're not going to be able to handle the ghost with the constipated call.
No one can ever handle the ghost with the constipated call.
Thank you. I feel like that should have been the tagline on the poster.
And just to finish this story up, in the end, he did say that the flashbacks are good. We're getting really close to where the 5 years is over and the first frames of season 1 started. So the flashbacks will probably be coming to an end. I will say, the way it sounds like they're using them, though, in this season,
it's not going to be as bad as Hong Kong.
No, Hong Kong was bad. I agree with you.
But that was some bullshit.
Yeah. It could be good. I'm really optimistic, actually, the way they seemed really optimistic the way they were talking about the season 4. So I'm excited, man. It's coming. We're almost there.
I know. October 7th.
And our last bit of Arrow news today is John Diggle will be suiting up in the season premiere of Arrow. So the bat, we're going to see him.
Here is the thing with this. It's not really like a suit.
It's not really like a suit. Let's show it for everybody right now.
Yeah, because like, get on our level. It's a fucking helmet with his leather jacket.
He looks like he saw the Power Rangers and was like, that's cool. I don't want to be that cheesy. Let me alter that.
I feel like the Atom, Brandon Routh, was literally like, hey, you want to borrow one of my like prototype helmets?
Yeah, it's,
and he was like
that.
Yes. Meanwhile, he's been running around for 4 other seasons looking like John Diggle, so everyone's gonna know you're the one black superhero in town. Like,
yeah, and the leather jacket is not really helping anything or anybody.
Look at his like pedophile black Dexter gloves too. Yeah, like, what are you doing, John Diggle?
And then also that's the whole thing. Like,
does he have a name?
No.
Not that I know of. I think he does have a name in the comics. I don't know if he's going by that moniker in the show. I guess that remains to be seen. But at the end of Arrow Season 3, he did tell him, he was like, you know, you might want to think about wearing a mask to protect your identity and blah, blah. And he was like, yeah, I'll consider that.
Considering like, in Season 3, his baby and wife got kidnapped literally every other episode.
Right. But this doesn't do that. Like, you're not concealing anything. Everyone sees your face.
Yeah, yeah. The thing that makes me upset about him is, like, I feel like the actor, like, came into work one day and they were like, dude, we got your suit. And he was like, yes, I'm going to look as good as Arsenal. And then they gave him a helmet. Like, here you go. Yeah.
I hope maybe this is just the first iteration.
Well, that's true. That was... That
maybe
was like,
we'll see it progress by the end. Who knows?
The only costume that was on fleek since the beginning, as the kids say, is Arsenal. Arsenal's costume was legit since the beginning.
Yeah, Arsenal's costume was good. Well, like we said, Arrow's too. We both really liked the first from the get-go.
We liked it, but like it wasn't like Green Arrow. Like now, this new costume in season four, like now I feel like it's Green Arrow.
It was, you know, it wasn't like when he had the long hair and the big straggly beard from the island. Mm-hmm. That is most definitely a callback to some of the future iterations of Oliver Queen in the comics. So I personally really liked it, the first iteration. The second iteration I wasn't so big on, and then this one I feel like is perfect.
Yeah, retweet.
But yeah, that's what Diggle's looking like. Let us know in the comments, guys, what you guys think about the suit, what you think about the Arrow suit, what you think about the season four trailer. We would love to hear your thoughts on that.
What you talking about, Zeno? That's where I went with that.
So moving on to some Flash news. Interesting. Tony Todd, who is most notably probably from the horror film Candyman. He played Candyman. Horror movie. Horror scary stuff. To voice Zoom in season two of The Flash.
Do you know like who Zoom is?
Yeah, Zoom is Reverse Flash, which is weird. That's the whole thing that's weird here.
Which is creepy. So this is gonna be like kind of like his like arch nemesis again, like all over again.
Right. But I don't understand.
It's gonna be voiced. Like, is he gonna play him too, or he's just voicing him?
He's
like,
just doing the voice. Well, we'll clarify that with these quotes right here. So,
okay.
Quoting from the production team, it says, "We wanted to do something like James Earl Jones as Darth Vader, this iconic voice coming out of the mask." And then they said, "The Zoom outfit is much more organic than the Reverse Flash suit, so it feels like it's alive." So with those quotes in mind, it sounds like it's gonna be.
It's more like an entity rather than a person.
It's going to be a different actor, yeah. If an actor at all, maybe it'll be CGI, I don't know. And then he'll just be providing the voice. No.
Yeah, I like them. Especially when they do like the super fat, like Reverse Flash and Flash Battle when, what's his name? Not Heatwave, the other one.
I don't know.
Firestorm? Robbie ML. Firestorm.
Yeah.
When Firestorm and Green Arrow came to help out, that was my favorite fight scene in the whole
season.
Well,
we've always said in our episode reviews last season that some of our favorite graphics from superhero television shows is from The Flash, which is weird because some of the ones on The Arrow look so bad, and the Flash, I don't know if they have a bigger budget or what, but it looks great.
Yeah, I'm so excited. And if they can pull this off, I feel like Tony Todd was terrifying to me as a child, Candyman. Mm-hmm. So like he could totally pull this voice off.
I am really curious though about like what's going on here. Like, is it Eobard Thawne? Is it like what? I don't know. Now we don't know what the hell's going on anymore. So
yeah, retweet.
I have to find out. But moving on into some other DC superhero news, Michael Shannon. Who played General Zod in Man of Steel, has clarified his flippers. so let's read this quote real quick. Now, this is in reference. We talked about this on the show before. He was saying, like, he looked down and he had flippers on his hands. Was it last episode?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, he said he had flippers on his hands in the one scene he shot for Batman vs. Superman. Here's a quote from him. Somebody was asking me about this in New York, and I made up some ridiculous bullshit. That is so obviously a complete bullshit story, right? But people took it seriously. That's actually hilarious. If it's true and he just made up some shit for the press to run with and they actually took and ran with it, that's awesome.
I love Michael Shannon.
Also, he could be covering his tracks now because he might have let something slip.
That's what I was gonna ask you, is do we think it's the reverse? I don't know. I mean, if he had flippers, it wouldn't shock me. They've done crazier things. The only reason why it kind of made sense was because Aquaman's gonna make an appearance in this movie, so I thought it would somehow like segue or like include Aquaman.
Aquaman's playing a brief part in the film, but I've been over it and I really can't see any reason that would lead to Zod having flippers for hands.
Like, maybe they, like, curse him, and they're like, you get full liberty.
Maybe. Maybe, but...
You are now a fish of the Atlantean world.
Kneel to fishman. Yeah. I just don't see it happening. I don't know. I personally, I think it's probably he was probably just bullshitting.
I hope his name as Flipper Man is Fishman. Like, I hope that's his superhero name.
Yeah, I could see that. But you think maybe there's some validity to this, or you think he's
I'm not gonna put anything out of the box of knowledge, but I will say that maybe he's stuffing the ballot box a little bit.
I'm putting it out of my mind. I don't think it's probably true. I think he's probably just messing around and people took it and ran with it.
Well, that was our short rumor roundup, y'all.
Moving on to this ridiculous son of a bitch. Steven Spielberg predicts the end of the superhero film.
What does he know? Has he even done a movie? Who is this Steven Spielberg?
Yeah, he's some nobody coming up from the streets. He's never done a damn
like
film
in that
his
indie
life.
Scene. Like, you don't know anything.
We were around when the Western died, he said, and there will be a time when the superhero movie goes the way of the Western. First of all, no shit. Point number two, his quote was, of course, right now the superhero movie is alive and thriving. I'm only saying that these cycles have a finite time in popular culture.
Listen to this. This is what I think. The reason why your Westerns died was because the acting was this. Hey, you, give me back the girl you stole. That's why those died.
Well, at the time, though, that was what the people knew to be good.
But, like, movies like The Dark Knight, movies like Captain America, Winter Soldier, like, those, we talk about it all the time, how those are movies that you don't need to love or appreciate comic books or superheroes in order to enjoy it. Like, they're still action movies at the end of the day. They're not, like, just, they can't just be in the superhero genre film. Like, if they can be in that genre, but they also, like, fulfill and put out the needs of, like, romance in some movies and, like comedies and like they fill out so many different genres. I think that's why they're so successful. Like my friends that are not nerds at all, they can all tell me who the hell Batman is. Like it's out there. You know what I mean? And
yeah, that's totally fair. That's totally fair. But also like,
so take that, Spielberg.
I feel like it's also like, well, why are you saying anything? Because you're stating the obvious. Obviously,
that's what I'm saying.
They're at the height of their popularity right now. And yeah, they're probably going to die down. I don't think they're ever going to totally die off because we do get some variations of Westerns today. We got, Cowboys and Aliens. We
Django
get
Django Unchained.
Right, we get Quentin Tarantino's Western. He's got another Western coming out right now. Granted, they're alternate takes on Westerns, but Westerns nonetheless. And I think, like, I don't really view this as a Western type of situation. I feel like superhero movie, comic book movie, period, is a genre at this point.
Yeah.
I feel like it's like science fiction, romance, drama, comic book movie. You know what I mean? Like, I think that's the way it is because there's not just superhero movies. There's, you know, Constantine, all these other types of movies that came from comic books. Kick-Ass.
They're always gonna do well too because everybody is looking for that new thing, that new IP to put out there, and it's so easy to take from materials that we already have. Look at Harry Potter. Look at Twilight. Like, it's easy to take established things that haven't been turned into films and try to interpret them in that light. So I think we're never gonna see them completely die out. The comic book is the same exact thing as a regular novel. It just has better pictures in it.
They're definitely gonna die down. No doubt about it.
Yeah.
We're at the height of it right now, and some people are feeling fatigued, sure, but I think it's safe to say you and I are ready for more. And I'm honestly fine with it when they do die down because they're telling all the stories that I want to see already right now. We're getting to Civil War, we're getting to Infinity Gauntlet, like
Apocalypse.
Yeah, like these stories took place within the last Civil War definitely took place within the last 10 years, 15 years. So like we're getting into recent comics now. So at some point they're going to have to slow down.
Yeah.
But Steven Spielberg really, there's no point for him to say anything, and I think maybe he's just a little upset because nobody asked him to direct the superhero movie.
It just makes me feel like this is like Nostradamus, like the end of the world is coming, like Steven Spielberg predicts. I'm like, you're a big deal, I get that, like you've done a bunch of stuff, and I'm really excited for your new HBO show, Westworld, that looks awesome, but don't come in here and take down my thing that I like, because I don't take down any of your pegs. I actually watch all your stuff, so...
I don't think he was really trying to be negative. I know a lot of people, of course, fanboys online blew up at him. Like, what do you even know? Superhero could be around forever. They're going to be around forever. And like, probably not, honestly. I love them probably more than most, but it is what it is. They'll definitely die down. And I do think that he would probably have changed his tune if he had been asked to direct one. So
retweet. That's how I was gonna end.
Moving on to probably my favorite news story of the day, and I'm just gushing about it. Let's hit it, Greg.
I can't believe that this happened.
I really can't believe it happened either.
Can you just tell the kids? Tell the kids. Tell the kids.
These are direct quotes we're going to read right now.
Oh, my God.
Chris Evans isn't ready to put down the shield anytime soon. In an interview with Collider, he's been quoting saying, if Marvel wants me.
Pause. This is his quote. Chris Evans said this.
Well, yeah, because I just told him that.
I know, but I'm excited. Like, we need to emphasize. Go.
Yeah, well, that's the one that I took the 2 seconds.
Hit me with it.
To tell them that. That was me emphasizing it. But thanks for the way to stop the show for no reason.
I love his face.
If Marvel wants me, they got me. They just can't stop making great movies. They do it in their sleep. It's wonderful directors and producers and actors and script, and it's like a playground as an actor. And he also...
Captain America, all of our theories are shot. He's never going to die.
Yeah, I was wondering about that, right? Because I feel like now Marvel is definitely going to be looking to,
Extend the contract, get a new contract going for sure. Wait, but listen to this. So I was thinking, you know how like Mark Hamill is always like Kevin Conroy, like if you do the Batman thing, like I'll do it with you because like we're a duo. Mm-hmm. I feel like, listen to this. If Chris Evans is like, guys, I don't want to stop being Captain America and go do these Avengers movies. Do you think like ScarJo, Chris Hemsworth, and RDJ are like, wait, he's doing more? We want to do more.
I don't know about them. I know about Robert Downey Jr. has been quoted recently saying like I would really love to just keep doing this as long as the role stays less physical.
They're making so much money. Chris Evans and RDJ. RDJ is the highest paid actor in movies right now.
Yeah, he's well, one the thing highest I thought paid was cool. Speaking of the money, is that way back when they had redone the contracts when this was such a big success, Avengers was such a big success, and they were like, okay, Robert Downey Jr., here's all the money in the world because we're renegotiating your contract, and then he was like, yeah, that's great, but these guys need to make more money too. And I was
Wow,
holy shit. Like, I couldn't even believe that happened. And they did it. They paid them more money because he was so like pivotal to the series that they were like, okay, I guess all the Avengers are getting like raises.
I feel like he's a real life Tony Stark.
So yeah, it was so awesome. And like, so now he's been saying he wants to stick around as long as the role is not too physical. Cause he's getting older.
Dude, and I would argue that if we get like old Ben Avengers, like I will cry. I hope they all have like walkers and canes. Like I would be so happy.
I'm down. Let it happen. Yeah. Chris Evans is probably, I would argue, like probably second most reputable as far as like actor to character as Robert Downey Jr. is to Iron Man. I think people are really starting to cling to him as Captain America, especially after Winter Soldier.
Yeah, you know what's weird too is that's what I was just gonna say is like. The Avengers kind of go in the route, like in the storyline of like switching over to Captain America leading them. But I feel like America and the world has gone over and like switched kind of like Captain America is kind of like the face of the Avengers.
Yeah, well, that's always my concern was because the promotional art for Avengers 1 always had Iron Man in the front. His helmet was off so everybody could see his face. Like it's Robert Downey Jr. It's that guy you guys all been loving now. Mm. And he was always in the front. And Captain America was like off in the background. And I was like, this is not the way it is. And then in the animated series, same deal. Iron Man was on the front of everything, always Iron Man this, Iron Man that. And I'm like, what is happening with this? But then I kind of realized Captain America was being built into being that leader role. Like, he didn't start off that way. And now you kind of slowly saw him take charge by the end of Avengers 1 and then Winter Soldier. And then in Age of Ultron, they straight up, Iron Man even straight up says, like, he's the boss. I just pay for everything.
So, yeah,
like,
really.
I kind of feel like they did that intentionally now, which is so everything they're doing with this
so smart
universe is very intelligent. Yeah, but
they're like the precursors in Jack and Daxter. Like they're the little ocelots that are just running stuff over there, and they like we don't know any of it, but they're just like, yeah, we have this whole plan and we're little orange lightnings. And I'm like, yes.
Yeah, they got a lot of smarts over there. But how do you think this is going to affect the theories that we've been saying lately? Do you think it is, do you think maybe they're still gonna kill him off and then bring him back as they did in the comics?
I just think that it's like if the actors are like, listen, Marvel, like we want to keep doing these movies, I just feel like Marvel would be dumb and retarded to be like, listen, you guys are out, sorry, we're bringing in phase 3. Like I feel like they just wouldn't do that. Like I feel like they're gonna make cameos now in all the new movies.
Well, they're all seeing phase 3 through, which is phase 2 is done now officially after Ant-Man. Phase 3, is that that's kicking off with Captain America, or did Ant-Man kick off phase three?
No. Ant-Man ended phase two.
Okay. So yeah, they're all going to be through phase three, which is Infinity Gauntlet part two. But after that, I don't know, maybe someone was supposed to die because of contracts and Infinity Gauntlet, and maybe now they're going to rethink it. Who knows what's going to happen from this?
That would be so cool. But I just like Chris Evans, and thank you for saying that quote because it gets me really excited as a nerd.
Yeah, same here, man. This is like things I think about, like, man, there's going to come a time when these guys don't want to do this, but like, this is seriously something I've like just like daydreamed about. Like, what if they just didn't? What if he's just like, I want to do this forever, and that's pretty much
that's
what
happened. That's why this story is so crazy. I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah,
that's why I had to emphasize and stop the show for a bit.
Yeah, it's really, really cool. So let's move on to some less exciting news after that. Now
we have this casting news,
but we'll get through it. We'll get through it. So let's just get through it real quick. Theo Rossi from Sons of Anarchy, Marchella Ali from House of Cards, and Simone Missick, Sons of Anarchy as well, have all been cast as villains Shades and Cornell Cottonmouth. And then Simone Missick has been cast as the hero Misty Knight, respectively, in Marvel's Luke Cage series coming to Netflix.
Okay, let's unpack this. So Theo Rossi is also from Divergent, which I don't know if you saw that, but he's really good in that.
Yep, there's a look at him, and there's a look at Shades right there, looking pretty so, like, awesome, I guess.
Guess would be a good word. But that's awesome. I feel like he embodies the character well, so good for you.
Mm-hmm.
Marchella Ali, I am obsessed with. He's phenomenal in House of Cards. He is so good in that show. And like, look at his character. Like, I feel like that's kind of scary.
Yeah, Cornell Cottonmouth looks pretty cool.
And Simone Missick is beautiful, and I'm obsessed with her too.
She is beautiful. I was putting this image in here, and I was like, what a beautiful woman.
She's just like a really gorgeous woman. And I think she's older too. Like, I think she's in her 30s, but like, she's hot.
I hope they change her costume to not be overly sexualized, because I just don't want them to do that typical thing with
women. I don't
think
they will with her.
Yeah.
She also kind of reminds me of Jada Pinkett Smith as Fish Mooney in Gotham.
A little bit.
But I think she's better looking. No offense, Jada.
Yeah, no doubt. I think everybody would agree with that.
Okay, but yeah, I agree with you. I hope they don't over-sexualize her.
Maybe not everybody would, but I do, and I'm all that matters, Greg, so you're good.
Retweet.
And finally, Rosario Dawson is also set to appear as her character Claire Temple, otherwise known
as
the Night Nurse.
I literally love her. Love Claire Temple.
Yeah.
And I love Rosario Dawson.
Rosario Dawson is sensational. I love her.
Like, I just don't get how they got somebody that famous. Like, I feel like she's so famous, and I'm just so happy that she's in these, like, television shows, because it just brings the caliber of them so much higher for me.
Yeah, she's a great actress. She's a beautiful woman. And
she's a beautiful girl.
Yeah,
I'm
excited. I'm glad she's getting more involved, and hopefully her character might grow into something really cool.
Yeah, she's set to appear in Jessica Jones, too, when that finally releases.
Mm. And then finally, Steven Ryder, I don't have a picture of him, is set to play New York District Attorney Blake Tower in Daredevil on Netflix as well.
Yep, and he is going to be basically like Alfred or Oracle. Probably mm-hmm. more Oracle.
Probably
he gives
Oracle,
all the information to Daredevil, like where to go capture the criminals and like what's going down. He'll be like, you got to get here now, Matt. And Matt will be like, I'm blind. I'm going.
I'm blind. What if he just announced before he did everything, I'm blind. I got to go to the bathroom.
I'd be so happy with that. We should parody that.
Guys, I'm a little
parched. I'm blind. I got to piss.
I'm a little bit parched. I'm blind. Give me ice water.
I'm blind. I'm diving off this building.
Or if like when he's standing off with like a villain in the street and they're like, who are you anyway? And he's like, I'm blind. I'm Daredevil. Yeah.
I feel like he would have to tell them after he beat the crap out of them to make them feel even worse about themselves. Yeah. Like he beats the shit out of them and he's like, by the way, motherfucker, I can't see. And he lifts up the thing. They're like, what? Like, that's who beat the shit out of us.
Yeah, I'm into that. I'm into this idea. You guys can use this, by the way, if Netflix you're watching.
Totally. I want the scene where he's like, I'm blind. I'm going. I want that to be in the script.
All right, moving on to number 9. Mark Ruffalo has come out saying Hulk was indeed written into the Civil War script, but it was removed.
Knew that this was a thing.
I did not.
Way back when we were talking, I think it was like episode 2, and we were talking like, oh, like Mark Ruffalo, is he going to be in the thing? Because now at the end of Age of Ultron, what happens? He goes into space, spoilers. Mm-hmm. But I've originally thought I read this somewhere, and then he revealed it. So continue. Sorry.
I did not have any idea, but he said in reference to where the Hulk is on and why, the reason is too great to be revealed in this movie.
Oh my god, are you low-key shitting? Mark Ruffalo's crazy.
I like this a lot for multiple reasons. One being that, first of all, it sounds like they're doing some really cool stuff with his version of the Hulk, which is great because he's my favorite version of the Hulk.
Retweet.
And two, they're being smart and not over bloating Civil War. Because
we already got so many people in this movie.
It's gonna be a big movie. As we heard by the budget, it's gonna be a big movie.
Oh God, rest our souls! But I'm so excited for it. But I think it's smart to not have every movie be an Avengers movie. Like at the end of the day, everyone keeps forgetting, and we keep having to remind ourselves too sometimes that this is a Captain America film. Like this is not
an Avengers movie. But it's gonna be an Avengers 3. It just is. They're all there pretty much, with the exception of Thor and Hulk now. But I mean, I feel like
they're the least of the Avengers that we need there.
Thor and Hulk to be in Civil War?
Like, I feel like if you want to have an Avengers movie, but, like, you had to get rid of two Avengers, I feel like I'd pick Thor and Hulk.
Really? That's the weirdest thing I've ever heard anybody say.
Who would you pick? Like, if you had to.
Black Widow, Hawkeye.
Oh, that's fucked. Seriously? That's fucked! We had a whole episode last week talking about how much we love Hawkeye.
Yeah, they're both cool, but if I had to get rid of two, right? And I'm there to see a superhero movie, I'm not going to leave the two humans in who can just walk around and like fight and shoot stuff. And then leave out the God of Thunder and the incredible fucking Hulk.
That's why you have to leave them out, because Captain America is more realized, more grounded.
Exactly. That's why you have to leave them in.
Leave them out.
No. Why would you need three characters that are more grounded and real?
Because this is like Batman. This is what I'm picturing. I'm picturing Batman going against Jason Todd.
In an Avengers movie, why would you need three characters that are all grounded and realistic?
Because I like them, okay?
That's nuts, dude. I would never leave out Thor. But for this purpose, I mean, you know, they're like, you know, game enders. Like, you can't have them there because... Whoever has them on the team wins.
We're also getting Black Panther. We're also getting Spider-Man. Like, so many people are making their first appearance in this movie, too. So I think it's smart on them.
Yeah, for sure. And it sounds like it's going to be a big reason, so.
Yeah, I'm just really excited to see what the fuck Mark Ruffalo is talking about. Like, good for you, Mark Ruffalo.
Yeah, seriously, man. He really owned that character, and it sounds like it's turning into something great for him. So
he likes the character, too, which is good.
Yeah, he plays it well, man. He plays it well. He does the motion capture for it as well. Is that
Yes.
And he's great, man. He's really great. Good for him. He deserved a big break like this.
Yeah, because he always plays like the awkward guy in like romance comedies, and now he has like a cool role for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. Moving on into some more Hulk news. Marvel reveals Totally Awesome Hulk number 1, and it will ship in December.
Okay, so Dean and I found out about this, spoiler alert, right before the show. And when we find out about it, I mean, we read about it, but then we totally forgot about it. But then we looked this up, and we were like, yes, we have to put this in the show. It looks so good.
It looks really cool. It looks like it's going to be a lot different.
So basically, the quote that came with the issue is saying that he's going to be the first Asian-American Hulk, which is awesome. I like his little, like, weird hairdo on top of the Hulk. I feel like that makes him more cool.
He's going to be – I don't know if part of this is wrong or right, but what I remember reading was he is the first Asian American leading hero in a Marvel comic book.
Oh my God, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Do we low-key love him already?
Possibly any comic book, but I don't know about that for sure. I know Marvel for sure.
So to be punny, they said he's going to be totally awesome in his own way. Totally awesome Hulk. But he's only a 19-year-old scientist, and he said that the guy really loves the character. So that's awesome. I'm excited. He wants to be the Hulk, and it's going to shake up things in the Marvel universe.
Yeah, he's overly confident, they said. He's excited about being the Hulk, whereas with Bruce, it was like such a curse and a burden, but this is not the case for him. Be interesting to see how the other characters, the other Avengers and stuff, will react to that if they make them play together, so...
I feel like he's gonna show up at like the Avengers like airship, right? And they're gonna be like, "What are you doing here?" And he's gonna be like, "Just being totally awesome."
I'm also excited to see what happened to Bruce, that they need a new Hulk.
Retweet. Yeah. Well, I feel like Bruce's life is just fucked. Like, if I'm being honest, like always fucked.
Yeah.
Like he never catches a break.
Yeah. So true.
God rest his soul. Big ups to Bruce Banner.
Big ups to Brucey B. moving on, Deadpool. This is a strange one, and it kind of it kind of crept up out of nowhere, but Deadpool the video game from 2013 has quietly been announced to be released on Xbox One and PlayStation 4 this November, November 17th, for $50, which seems a little bit steep to me, honestly.
I think they're doing it to hype up the new Deadpool movie, mm-hmm. for one, and I'm very excited because I never played it, and I heard that the game was decent enough, so I'm going to probably buy it on PS4.
I just actually recently, like, maybe a week ago, beat this game, which is so weird that it happened.
Are you low-key upset?
No, but I had it for a while. It was on my shelf, and like I mentioned earlier in the show, I'm working my way through my backlog, so it's very, very short. That's why I say that's a little bit steep. It seriously... I tried to stream it one night. The stream didn't go that well, but I kept playing afterwards for a few hours. I played it a majority of the next night, and I beat it by like 9 p.m.
Oh, that's not that good.
So $50. Is it fun? It's hilarious. It's hilarious, okay. And the combat is really satisfying. Yeah.
It's worth
playing, no doubt about it. I really enjoyed it. High Moon Studios developed it, which they're responsible for the good Transformers games, not the movie-based ones.
Oh, good for them. Yeah. Good for them.
But... $50 is steep for such a short game, and for a game that's a port, pretty much. I don't know.
It's better than 60.
It's better than 60. It's $10 better than 60. But, you know, if you haven't played it yet and you have one of the new gen consoles, there you go. Like, Greg here is going to play through it.
Woo!
We'll see what's up. It was weird. GameStop tweeted that out, and I was like, that's weird and unexpected, but it is what it is, I guess.
What are you going to do? Some people want to play this Deadpool on the new consoles.
Yeah, that's true. What are you going to do? Moving on, Thor Ragnarok and Captain Marvel are set to film in Australia.
Down Under.
Down Under.
Crikey, this is great news. I love it. It's so special.
Did they say when?
No, but they did say that it was because of the relationship. Disney obviously now owns the world, and they just finished filming Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man Tell No Tales, and they had a great experience over there, so they said they were going to continue doing that, and also because Thor has a family in Australia, Chris Hemsworth, everybody, is Australian, if you didn't know, and he lives there, so it's just going to be a convenience for him as well.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That'd be pretty cool for people he actually knows who live near him, and they're like, oh yeah, we're shooting the movie, you can come like on set and check it out. Like,
he's probably like, honey, come see what I do to support our lives. And she's like, for the first time, me.
No, I'm sure she's flown her out to be on set and his kids and stuff before. No way he's a part of that awesome Avengers world and never brought her in to check it out.
This is what I wanted to talk about with this story. So he has children. Imagine going to school and being like, my dad's fucking...
Aren't they
four.
Young, though? How old are they? I know he's like a baby.
One's like a toddler, so I think like three. And then the other one's like a newborn baby.
Yeah, so when they get older, though...
They're going to be like, my dad's so cool. He's a cop. My dad's so cool. Except they're probably Australian, not whiny little American kids. And then he's going to come in and be like, well, drop fucking Thor's hammer on the desk and be like.
My dad is the son of Odin, motherfucker.
I don't know who the fuck you guys think you are, but.
All right. And finally, our last story, a little bit of drama here at the Marvel Studios, which we don't really hear too much about over there.
Never with Marvel, really.
Things are usually pretty smooth sailing that we hear about. But Kevin Feige was set to leave Marvel after a debate over the budget of the latest Captain America Civil War sequel.
You read the last name wrong. Kevin Fudge, I think, is a typo there.
No, that's not wrong. So how long ago was this feud?
This happened 2.5 weeks ago.
That recent?
Yeah, it was very recent. Wow. So it happened 2.5 weeks ago, and he was thinking about leaving Marvel, but just because he was trying to do, I think, in like post-op, because I think it was last week that we announced that Captain America Civil War had just been done shooting.
Yeah, well, a lot of the special effects that we all see and take for granted in these films are what costs like a lot of the money. So, he wants to make this look good,
not
cheesy, so...
So in post, he was trying to put on all these effects, trying to make everything, I guess, look as phenomenally as he'd envisioned. Mm-hmm. And Marvel is basically like, listen.
As he envisioned?
I hated that. Paul Bettany, shout out to you, big up. Basically, so they were like, listen, like, you can't be spending all of our money on this one movie. And he's like, you don't understand. Like, this movie's going to make you back all the money that I'm spending and some. And it's easily going to. Like, it's going to be so big.
Yeah.
So he almost left Marvel until Joe Quesada, the CEO of Creative Affairs, was like, listen, boobos, let me figure this out. I'll find money in another place, and gave him the money so he wouldn't leave. Isn't that crazy, though?
Yeah, it is nuts that he would just be ready to up and go when, like, he's got a whole another phase to finish out. And he's godfathered all of this into play. So that's, I don't know. I feel like Maybe there's something we're missing there. Maybe he was just playing hardball and he was trying to make him think. Like, it seems odd that he would be
the thing
so
that
ready to
scares
leave.
Me is that, like you said, like he has all of phase three to still commit to. And like, if he's the head of it and it's that shaky that he would just be like, all right, I'm walking away. I quit. I'm done. Like, I'd be like, wait.
Yeah, that's why I'm kind of feeling like maybe we're missing something, or maybe he was like just putting a poker face on, because like, that's a lot to just walk away from.
Maybe they kidnapped one of his kids and held
maybe
him.
Maybe they did kidnap one of his kids.
Why do you know what? Agree with my nonsense?
I love you so much.
Ah, your face.
Civil War, though, is bound to be a huge box office hit. Whether the movie's good or bad, we don't know. Obviously, we all want it to be great because we wanted to see this story for so long. But it's going to make money. When that poster comes out and it's Captain America and Iron Man head-to-head and they're like, and it's like, choose a side or something epic like that. Right there is butts in the seats. They're going to make so much money.
Did they hire you to do the marketing for Civil
They
War?
Should.
Because that sounds like the baby Jesus in the nativity.
They're
going like,
to make
instead of
like
oh my
bank,
God.
Dude. That's guaranteed.
What
people
I really
are going
want,
to see this.
I want the poster for the movie to be that concept art that we showed off last week of the two sides going against each other and like all of them, but then
but like
Iron
live
Man
action
America. Oh my God, I'd poop in my pants if they released that.
I would like to see that in some of the promotional art, but like live action. But I feel like the poster I want to see as minimalistic as possible, like I don't know. Maybe they'll do two different versions. Like, you know how when you buy, if you buy like a game where like there's morality choices, you can get like an evil cover or a good cover. Yeah. I would like to see like some theaters have like Captain America like holding Iron Man's helmet in his head, and then like another poster with like Iron Man like with the shield cracked in half. You know what I mean? Like something cool. That would be really cool marketing to like have both sides displayed at different theaters.
I want it really bad, but now I feel like I'm gonna have nightmares.
I'm ready, dude. This is my favorite Marvel story, so I am like, I do nothing but think about this all day long. Pretty
I feel
much.
Like we're gonna. We have to see this together. I don't know how it's going to work, but we have to.
That would be ideal. I would love to. So maybe we'll have to make that happen. But that's it for the news, guys. Let us know what you guys think about all this in the comments below. And with that, we're moving on to our topic of the week. This week, it was my topic. And I want to talk about over-teasing and over-hyping fans. Do the fans see too much? I don't know how exactly to word this, but... you know, we see a lot of stuff ahead of time before these movies come out, whether it's trailers, promo art like we just talked about, clips. They release all these clips in the movies. Avengers Age of Ultron, I feel like I saw a good 45 minutes of that movie before the trailer even came out. So, like, I wanted to get into that some a bit with you. So first of all, let's talk about how much is too much when they're teasing a film.
Can I give you... one of my all-time favorite trailers first of The Dark Knight.
I don't even remember.
You have to look it up after this. Everybody go do yourselves a favor. This was the most minimalistic trailer in the world, and they kept the Joker in the shadows for so long. And if you guys remember, as the movie was coming out, everyone was skeptical on the gay actor from Brokeback Mountain coming in to do the Joker. They were all like, how is he gonna pull this off? And when the trailer released, everyone was like, oh my God, he's terrifying. Yep. Like, he's scary as balls. And that, I think, was like the perfect trailer, because they didn't give away any of his lines. They just kind of showed like glimpses of him. Like, I'm pretty sure we didn't see the Joker until like you went to go see the movie.
The marketing, just
like
everything.
You saw like his lip, like you would see like his white face, or you would see like him holding up a card and just like his white hand and the green hair or something. Like, you never saw him full endowed in like the costume until you went to go
see the movie. Christopher Nolan was very, especially about the sequel, especially about The Dark Knight, when everyone knew it's Batman and the Joker. This is the biggest, like, evil good struggle in comic books, arguably. He was really good about hiding that. He's really good about keeping things under wraps in general for all of his films. But
yeah, for sure.
This one, man, the viral marketing on that with the ha-ha-ha, you go to the news, you go to the Gotham Gazette and see the Gotham Gazette, and they give you, you know, like, stories here and there without actually telling you what's happening in the film, which was great.
Yeah, it was awesome. I just think that route of going at it is awesome. But then as far as just like trailers in general and like how long they should be, we were just talking about Arrow earlier in the show, and that trailer kind of showed you everything that you're going to be expecting. And it's like at that point, like, I get it. Like, you want to tease me about everything, but like, you didn't have to literally show me a segment from each of your episodes this season. Like, it's too much.
Yeah.
And that was what? Only like a 3.5 minute trailer?
Yeah.
So only like 3 minutes and 30 seconds, which I think is way too long.
I think it's way too long, which is our next bullet point. But before we move on to that, I was just thinking, like, I remember searching for an image of the Joker, like, trying to, like, I want to see what he looks like in the movie. And, like, when I was, first of all, super hard pressed to find one anywhere.
Yeah.
And when I finally did find one, I was like, is this even real? I don't know, because they were so good about hiding. It was the one, the background was all black.
And yes!
it was just his white face, like, kind of looking up, and you could see his lips. And I was like, I don't even know if this is real or not. I can't tell
that
anymore.
That was my wallpaper on my computer.
Crazy.
For the longest time. It was crazy. I loved that picture.
So that was like, that's the kind of approach I would take now.
Yeah.
As far as like how much is too much. Like, don't tell us plot points.
Yeah.
Just give us like these are your characters.
Yeah.
This is generally what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. You don't have to go into specifics.
The only news that should be released before a movie is casting.
Mm-hmm.
I think so people can speculate that way. Like, we knew Heath Ledger was going to play the Joker.
Mm-hmm.
We just didn't know what he looked like. And then as far as that goes, as far as the trailer goes, give us like what makes, like, set the tone for your movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, don't give us what the movie's going to be about. Don't give us the best, funniest line. Like, that was the problem I had with Ant-Man. It was hysterical. I loved Ant-Man, but I feel like a lot of those lines, that was like, oh, I saw this in the coming attraction. I was just going to, like,
that's a problem I have with a lot. And, you know, all movies are guilty of this, but superhero movies are the worst about it.
Like, Age of Ultron with the hammer, with Thor's hammer, everyone trying to pick it up. I'm like, come on. Like, this was all in the trailer. Like, they kind of ruined it.
They played that trailer on, they played that clip online. They played that clip on talk shows. They played that clip, like, on TV. Like, what do you do? That was one of the that was when the villain,
and that was
came
my favorite
out.
Scene. Yeah, that was my favorite scene of the movie.
Marvel's really, really bad about it. I say all the way back, not with Iron Man 1, because I remember the same deal with the Joker in Iron Man 1. I was really hard pressed to find anything about Iron Man 1. And then I saw the trailer on TV, and it was very short. It was maybe 45 seconds. Iron Man, it was just blue skies, jets flying, and then Iron Man come whizzing by, he goes supersonic, and then he's out. And I was like, holy shit, that's Iron Man. And like, and then after that, with the success of that, when Iron Man 2 was coming out, I saw that whole movie before I saw that movie. Like, and then that was it. Marvel is very, very bad about that kind of stuff.
Well, that's why I think when we're discussing this too, like, that's what worries me about, like, the Batman vs. Superman trailer was good.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I hope that's not, like, I feel like the more we're seeing on that movie, like, I'm seeing that whole movie before it comes out. The only thing that I feel like is really a mystery to me at this point in that film is Wonder Woman. Like, she's still the wild card for me.
Already, like, with that, the ha-ha-ha on the Joker's costume, don't show us that. That would have been something amazing to see in the movie
as
a surprise.
Yeah.
Wonder Woman would have been amazing to see as a surprise.
Yeah.
Like,
Aquaman's gonna appear now, we know. Like,
like,
all that stuff. Like,
just
come on.
Keep it for the film. Keep it under wraps. There's no better feeling, especially as a comic book fan, a superhero fan, to walk in there and be like, what? Like, at the end of Iron Man 1, when Sam Jackson comes out after the credits, he's like, I'm putting a team together. And everybody was like, what? Like,
the theater,
nobody
I
saw that coming.
Everyone shit their pants. Like, people screamed at the
end.
They were
there,
like,
was audible yelling in the theater I was in.
Yeah, that was crazy. But, like, that's what gets me now is, like, Christopher Nolan taking Batman and doing that because he didn't have this whole studio behind him besides Warner Brothers. But, like, he's still, like, total creative reign and freedom. Like, are we ever going to get, like, those surprises, those Easter eggs? Like, as a nerd, it's fun to me, like you said, if I had went to go see Batman vs. Superman and be like, watching the trailer, that was the first thing I said to you when we saw the trailer. I was like, did you see the Robin costume?
Right.
I'm like, oh my god, like, you like to, as a nerd, pick out the Easter eggs, because that's what makes an Easter egg fun, is you discovering them, not somebody blatantly being like, wow, there was a Robin costume here at 3 minutes and 10 seconds.
Yeah,
like, it's annoying.
And then you go through and analyze it, and then the next day there's HD images of every frame of the trailer, and you're like, well, this guy's here, this guy's there, this guy's doing this, like, so let's discuss what's a good length for a trailer, would you say?
A minute to a minute and a half.
Yeah, no more than a minute and a half, I say.
Nope. I think that's at the most. And I think that the best trailers are the teaser trailers, as they call them, teasers. But I think they're what a trailer should be. And that's the minute length of just, like, laughter or, like, someone's voice over, like, a black screen. Mm-hmm. I think video games could teach movies a bunch of things.
Yeah.
For video game trailers, the Uncharted 4 Thief's End trailer, if anybody's ever seen that, go do yourself a favor and look that up. The original
great
one
trailer,
where it was just showing the map and all the treasures and everything, and it was just the Todd Stashwick's voice.
Yeah.
So phenomenal. And then the most recent one for the Nathan Drake collection, and it's just solely like going over and being like, we had a lot of adventures and they were all awesome, and like just going over like a general area.
Well, that
but
one's
like
got a little bit of leeway because they show some surprises and stuff, like spoilers for Uncharted if you play it. What are you doing if you haven't played it?
Retweet.
Like young Nathan Drake when he was a kid, they show that and stuff, but like not when those games were coming out, you didn't hear anything about that. And that's something that if there was like a scene with young Tony Stark or young Bruce Wayne, like we saw the flashback of Bruce's parents, like why
it's so annoying. But with the pearls in the air, like that made me so sick. I'm like, why did you show this? Like, I'm excited to see it, but I'm like, why?
I don't know. I think it's a minute 15 to a minute and a half is that sweet spot. And I think not exactly superheroes, but Star Wars The Force Awakens trailer, perfect.
Phenomenal. The first one. Not the most recent. The first one they released was phenomenal. Just the flashes of like everyone's faces.
Yeah, we saw a little bit. What was the most recent one with Han and Chewie at the end?
Yeah.
You didn't like that one?
The first one, I liked it. I just think the first one was my ultimate, like, that's the epitome of what I think a perfect trailer is. Like, I saw that trailer, and after I watched it, I was like, what the fuck? And I rewatched it like five more times. Yeah. Like, that was an amazing trailer. It just showed you, like, it showed you the black actor, I always forget his name, and he's playing Finn, and it showed you Daisy, the girl, and then it just showed you all the flashes just with like a voice talking over it, like my sister had the Force, like my brother had it now. Like, that's so awesome. And then at the end of that, all you see is Kylo Ren's saber turn on, and it's like, but the Sith are coming back. And I was like, what? Yeah. I was like, dude, like that blew my mind. Like,
it was a great trailer. Even the newest one was great. It showed you what everyone wanted to see. It showed you a look at Han, Harrison Ford back with Chewie, some of the old school guys. It showed you some of the conflict. It showed you all the new characters. But at the end of the day, we don't know a fucking thing about that movie. And that's the way it should be.
I have no clue. Right. Like, when I go to watch that on Christmas Day, I'm going there, and I'm going to sit there in the movie theater on Christmas and say, thank you, Santa Claus, for giving me the best present.
Right, and we talk about it all the time. We speculate on Level Up. Greg and I talk about it, you know, off the show, and, like, we don't know what's happening in that movie. It looks awesome. We can't wait to see it, but we really don't know anything, and that's what a good trailer should do. It should get us excited without telling us what's going on. John Boyega, by the way, is the actor that plays Finn.
Yes, love him. He was in 24, Live Another Day. He was phenomenal in that. That's how he got cast for this role.
So we both agree then, probably like a minute and a half. Retweet.
I mean, the Deadpool trailer wasn't terrible. I think that was a little long.
No, the Deadpool trailer was bad, but that's a... Even then, they showed a little bit over the top. Like, we could have just done with one glimpse at it at the action sequences. They showed maybe three or four action sequences.
And I'm hoping that they didn't butcher a lot of the funny lines, like the moment where he's talking with the guy, the avocado line. Like, right. I'm hoping that. And you guys can go check out our reaction to that trailer, too. We have that on our YouTube channel here. So you can go youtube.com/TheLevelUpShow, level spelled LVL. We reacted to Deadpool, the red band one, the good one. And, like, they just kept throwing out a bunch of funny lines. And I'm like, I hope that this is still funny to me, like, when it comes out. Like, it will be, but, like, you know?
Yeah, and
like,
then...
That's why Ant-Man was... I was like, what? Like, it was kind of disappointing when I saw it. I was like, come on.
I like when they do... When they use those funny lines in the trailers, but then in the movie, you get a different line.
Yes.
That's nice, that's because it shows you the tone they're going for without ruining the best lines for you. What's not great is when they use the best lines in the trailer and then they just cut it and then they don't put anything there. Yeah. Like, what happened to this? And then, like, that's kind of annoying because then you had the funny line spoiled for you and you don't get anything to replace it in the film.
Retweet.
But
I feel like Stanley should be just cameo in all the trailers instead of cameoing in all the movies. I feel
that would be nice. Awesome. So, what are some of your, to just wrap this up in a bow here?
Hit me with it.
What would be like some of your favorite trailers? I know we discussed a couple, but like some of the superhero ones that really did it right.
Dark Knight for me. I think that's my all-time favorite.
That was a good one. That was a really good one. That was a strong choice to start off with.
Avengers, the very first Avengers trailer, when you saw them and the camera, it's the Battle of New York. It was like a minute and a half. I think it was like so short, but it ended and it just showed you all of them in a circle. Like, and the camera panning around.
Oh, I know that. Like, I have that above my TV back there, that frame. I love that shot.
That trailer made me feel things I've never felt about a film.
It's funny because at the time, I remember watching it like on repeat, and now yes. I cannot remember the trailer for the life of me.
And then what's another really, really good one? Ant-Man was good. Like, it made me excited to see that movie. And I enjoyed Ant-Man a lot
Ant-Man
more than
was
I
good,
I
but again, they did the same thing. They showed us the villain. They showed us every conflict, a part of every conflict that they had together in that movie, except for the suitcase fight. Spoilers for Ant-Man, my bad.
Do you know what I think did it really well? Guardians of the Galaxy. Because nobody knew about that. And
no, that was a great trailer.
They hyped that up well without giving away a lot of the film. So Guardians of the Galaxy would be another good one for me. What about you?
I would also argue that Avengers, it was kind of a different story because it was the culmination of these movies, and it was just a big action movie. It was just a big fight scene, pretty much. So it was hard to really spoil much besides the big stuff, like spoiler warning, I guess, Coulson dying, and because I don't know, I feel like everybody knows about that now, especially with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. on, but some of my favorites, I don't know. Some of my favorites are a lot of the times the ones that are too old anymore, because all the new ones now, I love them. I love seeing them. I get really hyped up about it, but like, they just show too much. They just show too much.
No.
I actually really appreciate a lot of the animated movies trailers.
Yes. A lot of, especially DC animated films, like their trailers for DC animated is one of the best things and most underrated things, I think, in this entire world. Like, their stories are so mature. Like, they might be told in a cartoon like fashion, but like, their stories are so mature. They're so phenomenally well done and well written, and the voice acting is always on point. Mm-hmm. And the trailers, especially the trailer that makes me so excited to see it, and I still haven't yet, is the Suicide Squad one. Was it Assault on Arkham?
That Batman
cameos in. I want to see it so bad, and I keep putting.
I never watched the rest of that. I started it, and I never watched the rest of it.
But that was like a phenomenal trailer. They gave you like Harley laughing and like going crazy. They gave you the Joker in his cell with the gun. That whole scene where they're like interweaving, and he's like, "Do I shoot you with the gun or do I kill myself?" And like him just being crazy. And then they show you the one scene of like Batman just flying off the gargoyle, and you're like, "What? He's in this too?" Like, it was crazy.
One of my favorite superhero trailers of all time, if not the favorite, say what you will about the movie, but the trailer for Man of Steel was perfect.
Oh, yes.
Christ. Yeah. That score.
When he, like, all you see is the earth start to shake and he takes off for the first time and that song plays. I don't know the name of the song, but
I don't know. It's a Hans Zimmer score. I have that score on my phone, actually, because I love that trailer so much. It's so good, dude.
That did stuff to me.
And then we had Russell Crowe narrating as his father, saying, what if a child aspired to be something more? And then he was like, he was learning how to fly, and that's, oh my God, the drums kick in. That trailer gave me chills multiple times. It was so good.
I remember watching it for the first time online, too, and I was like, wow. And then I remember going to the movies, because I go every Tuesday, and it played in, like, the coming attractions, and then I was like, wow.
Yeah, there was a really special feeling from seeing it on the big screen in front of you. You were like, it was a moment. You were like, this is Superman. He is Superman. Yeah.
I know people joke a lot, and they're like, it's a totally, like, these is, like, there are some movies that you have to see in the theaters, but, like, for superhero films especially, like, I feel like if you don't go see them, like, even Ant-Man, I feel like, was just more appreciated just watching that on a big screen. It's easy for me to say because I watch everything every Tuesday, but, like that Man of Steel, like, oh, my God, seeing that in movie theaters or the Dark Knight in theaters. I saw the Dark Knight in theaters, like, 17 times.
Yeah,
like,
same here, man. We've talked about that before, I think. Maybe not on the show, but, yeah, I saw the Dark Theater. I saw the Dark Knight a lot in theaters. But yeah, see, those two DC ones, The Dark Knight was great, and then Man of Steel, I think, was my... I like the movie a lot. I actually loved Man of Steel. I know it's not a popular opinion, but if only that trailer was... If only the movie was as good as that trailer.
Yes.
Oh, wow. Like, that trailer was so good, dude. Really,
Diane
really good.
Lane. What's her name? Diane Keaton?
She
plays Diane Lane, right? But is her real name Diane Keaton?
She doesn't play Diane Lane. She plays Martha Kent. But it's Diane Lane.
But is her, like, the actress that plays her, is it Diane Lane or Diane Keaton?
I don't know. I'm looking her up now. Diane Lane.
Because they both sounded right. Who the fuck is Diane Keaton?
Keaton is a person. She's older. Oh, yeah. She's much older. Diane Keaton is much older.
What is she from?
She was in that movie with Jack Nicholson where they're, like, old and in love.
Yeah.
Most recently, but more notable from back in the day, she was in the Godfather trilogy.
Big ups to Diane Keaton.
Her resume is long, dude. She's been in everything. But Diane Lane is the one you're thinking of.
The reason why I thought of her was because I watched an interview with her on Ellen and they got really drunk on the show and she's fucking hysterical.
She is
like
funny.
I didn't realize
she's
how funny,
funny
she was. Yeah. She's so funny.
Another one I want to mention that was really, really great and ahead of its time that actually got cut from the movie. But the original trailer, I don't know if you remember this because you how far apart are we? We're like 5 years apart, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you legitimately might not remember this trailer.
Hit me with it.
But it was the very first ever trailer for Spider-Man, the Sam Raimi Spider-Man 1. Any recollection of this? It was Spider-Man. It was two helicopters flying through the city, looking over a bank robbery. The helicopter drops in. They drop off guys to go rob the bank. They get away with the money. And then it pans back. You just see the helicopter's like, something's wrong. We're going down. And then everything goes quiet and the helicopter's just like still on the screen. And then it pans back to a giant spider web between the Twin Towers, which they cut from the movie because then 9/11 happened.
Oh yeah.
And the helicopter
I remember
was
this.
Stuck in the web between the Twin Towers.
I remember this because in the game too, when you played the game based on the first movie, the Twin Towers were in the game, but then they were cut from the game too. The game got delayed.
Right.
Yeah. I
so
forgot about that.
So this was...
Wow.
I'm trying to look it up now to see how long ago this was because I was... The movie came out in 2002. Right? So let's say the trailer they usually release like 5 months before that.
I would have been 8 years old.
You would have been 8 years old. I was in middle school. I was just getting out of eighth grade, I believe.
I was third grade. That's insane when we put our ages like that.
Yeah, it's weird. It's weird because now you're 21.
I know.
I'm almost 26. It doesn't seem like that big of a difference.
Not at
but,
all.
Yeah, it's...
You could have babysat me.
it's a big of a difference when you think about it, but...
That's crazy.
That trailer was great, man. And then they showed a quick shot of Spider-Man, like, peering out behind a brick wall, and that was...
And doesn't, like, the Green Goblin, like, laugh in the trailer? One of the trailers for that?
He might. That was a long time ago, but...
Because I loved the Green Goblin laugh.
That was the first trailer I've ever seen. I remember I was... Spider-Man's always been my thing. I remember I was down the shore. I was in Ocean City, which is a beach in New Jersey, if you know.
Love Ocean City.
And I'm walking off the boardwalk. I'm with my mom, and I'm with my good friend Eric. And there is a movie theater on the boardwalk, and they have all the posters going down the wall as you walk off and on the boardwalk. And I just remember seeing a brick wall, and then half of Spider-Man's face, like, peering out and hand wrapped around the wall. And I, like, looked over, and I just didn't think anything. I, like, looked back over, and I was like,
the fuck?
No way, because like this wasn't a thing at that point. This didn't, not every character got a movie, and I was like, is this really happening? And I dragged Eric and we all just stared at the poster, and I was like, holy shit. And then that was the first trailer, which I spent probably a good 3 hours downloading off of Kazaa on the internet because the bandwidth
was
bad. Yeah, it was so bad back then, dude. But
yo, Kazaa was the shit.
Yeah, Kazaa was awesome. If only
I
it was legal.
Yeah, really sweet. Wow, that just made me think of like my childhood.
Yeah, it was back. We just took it back for a minute. But that's it for me. Do you have anything else you want to add to this topic?
No, I really like where we ended on this one. I'm like happy.
Yeah, it was a good ending.
I'm like very content with our lives.
So let us know. What are your some of your guys' favorite trailers? What do you?
Yeah, I'm excited to see what you guys come up with.
Yeah, like, for sure. I'm sure we missed some. So let us know in the comments what you guys think is too much oversharing for the trailers, and what do you think is a good length and some of your favorite ones. We would love to hear from you guys about that. I don't believe we have any questions this week.
We do not, guys, because you should be emailing us questions, your comments, your feedback, your concerns. You can do that by hitting us up at our email address. Hit us up is what the kids say now, Dean. At our email address, which is powerup@thelevelupnetwork.com. That
send
is everything spelled out exactly as it sounds. You can send us anything. Tell us we suck and we'll put you on the show. And then we'll tell you you suck right back. Tell us we're beautiful and you love my Jewish nose and Dean's haircut. And we'll tell you, listen, we love your Jewish nose.
Or lack thereof. It's getting real out of control these days.
Yeah, I kind of like it though.
Oh, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions you want to talk about? Anything you want to just hit up real quick before we go?
The only question I had to, we kind of answered already, and that was the Chris Evans theory. Like, maybe they wouldn't kill him anymore, but we kind of answered.
Yeah, well, I was talking about this, with my same spoiler alert, guys. All those years after that Spider-Man poster, me and my good friend Eric are still good friends. We've known each other since we were four.
Big ups to Eric.
Big ups there, Kiefer. I think they might take the death and rebirth route that they did in the comics.
It would make sense.
I don't know. Time will tell. I really don't know what's gonna. That was the last thing I ever expected was him being like, yeah, let's keep going.
Spoilers for episode 8 of Power Up, guys. Dean and I will be cast in the new Avengers movie.
I'm so down. I would literally drop everything.
I feel like you would be the Hulk and I would be like Black Widow. Tell me not.
Hulk is the strongest there is. I actually said that. I was taking a shower last night and all of my
hot and steamy day.
All of my towels were in the wash. So they were in the dryer, so I had to use a beach towel. I grabbed a beach towel to dry off with when I got down my shower, and I put it over my shoulders, and I usually like dry my back off, and I ripped it completely in half. And then I walked out of the shower and I showed Jen. She was like, "What did you do?" And I said, "Hulk is the strongest there is."
Jen probably hates when we're together because we're such nerds. Probably. I love it.
She's used to it by now.
We love Jen.
But I guess that's it, guys. Like Greg said, send us your questions at powerup@thelevelupnetwork.com. And this segment will be reserved just for you, and we'll read them live on the air and hopefully answer your distress calls. But this has been another episode of Power Up, episode 7. We're getting close to episode 10 already. Can you believe it?
I feel like we're hitting our first milestones, and I wouldn't want to hit milestones with anybody else except for a beach towel ripper like you.
Me too, Greg. Me too. Wait a minute. Episode 10. Will you be here for episode 10?
Oh my God! Don't throw this curveball at me now. Well,
let's think about it.
We'll figure this out. Yeah, because I might poop.
Hopefully, we'll do something cool for episode 10. But yeah, that's it for this episode, guys. Subscribe to us on YouTube at youtube.com/levelupshow. Level spelled LBL to join us every Saturday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for a new episode. Or you can head over to SoundCloud and iTunes for the audio version, which is usually later than the video version, but it gets there eventually. And all of the Level Up Network shows are also on iTunes and SoundCloud. So you can follow us there. If that's not enough for you, follow me at @TheBeast_NJ. Or you can follow Greg on Twitter @GregVirga. Follow us. We'll talk to you. Superhero stuff or non-superhero stuff, it doesn't matter. We be tweeting. We be tweeting.
We be tweeting. We be tweeting. That's a Beyonce lyric for you. You're welcome.
So good, Greg.
And thank you. I look like a maniacal, insane human being, but you know what you guys should do? You should follow us because we're that amazing. Subscribe to us, heart us, and we'll heart you and subscribe to you right back because we're all crazy.
This is all true. It's all 100% true. Greg has lost his mind, so that must mean it's time to go. So, guys, crazy. Until next time, power up. Dude, I gotta stop doing it. I gotta stop doing that.
Yeah, it's all right. It's just a little habit that you have that we'll be able to get rid of. It's so
okay. I'm just not gonna touch it. Okay, ready?
Ready.
I'm ready now.
That made me physically, emotionally, mentally, and literally sick.
Yeah, I feel all of those things. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 7 of Don't Make Me Laugh. Come on, you motherfucker. All right, let's go. Come on, clean it up. Clean it up.